We've been going through the Lord's Prayer, this great model and example of how we are to pray and the different parts of prayer. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, where he says, he starts off and he says, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye." After this manner, meaning this is the model, this is the example. What's included in this prayer should be included in your personal prayer life. "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father which art in heaven." And we spent some time talking about that. Just the miracle of prayer being the bridge between heaven and earth. You know, I love that one line in the song that we just sang, and I can't remember exactly how it goes, but, you know, where it's talking about in his presence, heaven and earth become one. And that says it all. That's prayer. "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." And we talked about praise and worship and the importance of worship. One of the primary importances of worship is that it gets our eyes off of ourself and gets our focus back on a miraculous, all-powerful, holy God. And that's where our focus should stay. But this life keeps trying to rob us of that, doesn't it? Jose was talking yesterday about, and we were talking back and forth about how this world system just constantly grabs at our heart and wants to pull us down to live in this realm instead of living in the heavenly realm with our Father. "Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven." We talked about that aspect of coming to absolute surrender in prayer to where our heart and our will is wholly surrendered to him. And we can come to that place of saying, "Father, whatever you want to do in me, through me, to me, have your way, Father. I am your vessel to do your bidding." And then we want to talk this morning about this verse 11. "Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors." That will probably be next Sunday. "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." All right, so let's talk about verse 11. "Give us this day our daily bread." Talking about the necessity of our dependence upon him and how truly dependent we are. One thing that I hope to make very clear this morning, you and I are far more dependent upon him than we know. Your very next breath depends on him giving you that breath. Your next heartbeat depends on him keeping you alive. And he says here, "Give us this day our daily bread." And in the original language, and as you start to browse through some of the commentators, they all make mention of the fact that that word "daily" becomes very important. It kind of sticks out in the original Greek. It's prominent in this verse, the aspect of not just the bread that we eat, but our daily bread. And if you look at the meaning of it, it's talking about the bread of our necessity, our subsistence, what is needful for today, to make it through the day, to live. I think it's probably safe to say that none of us here in this room, on a daily, yearly basis, really understand daily bread. To put it into perspective, you would kind of have to look at it this way. How many of you woke up this morning anxious, thinking, "What am I going to eat today? There's nothing in the fridge, nothing in the cupboards. What am I going to feed my children today?" I dare say that not one of us had that worry, right? And yet, because we don't have that concern, it really robs us of a living, active faith. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 4, remember the story of manna? And the Israelites were out in a wilderness where there was no provision. No water, no food. It was a desert. It was a wilderness. Nothing there for them to eat. Then the Lord spoke to Moses and he said, "Behold, I am about to rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather" what? "A day's portion every day. That I may" what? "Test them, whether they walk in my law or not." The importance of daily food is this. I put there in your notes, daily bread necessitates the exercise of daily trust. How am I going to live today? What am I going to eat today? How am I going to pay this bill today? In the surplus of abundance, faith is not exercised, and that faith grows weak. Our minds really need to be renewed. You know, we would much prefer to be in the realm of abundance where I don't have to worry about tomorrow. I've got food for tomorrow. I've got food for next week. Most of us probably in our house. How long do you think you could live off the food in your house right now? Probably a couple weeks, right? If you really had to. And so because of that, you know, our minds kind of trust in that. We feel secure, and we no longer have an active working faith in the providence of God. But if we didn't have that abundance, and we woke up every day having to trust in God for food and provision for today, then our faith would remain sharp, strong, active. So what would you rather have this morning? Would you rather have abundance and a lazy faith? Or would you rather have nothing and a strong faith? And the answer to that question really reveals our hearts, doesn't it? I mean, I'd rather have a sloppy, weak faith. I'd rather have the abundance, is what I'm saying. But it's not good for us. It's not healthy for us. Eternally, it would be much better if we had to depend upon God. I mean, really depend upon God every day to where I have nothing if God doesn't come through. That's where our faith would be strong. And I think if we learned how to walk in that kind of faith, in the end, we would say, boy, I'd much rather be here than with a lot of abundance. Because here my faith and my walk and my communion with God is so sharp and clear, and it's not muddied over with all of these excesses and options. So the aspect of daily bread, give us our daily bread. I put there, daily bread teaches us of our utter dependence upon God for our very next breath, heartbeat, and sustenance. Where if God doesn't give me my next heartbeat, I'm dying. Is it that real to us? This culture teaches us just the opposite. Our culture and the world system teaches us of pride and independence, right? I've got my 401k and I've got my pensions and I've got my future planned out and I've got my bank accounts and I'm set, right? It's amazing how fast that stuff can go. I remember my dad and my mom back in 2008, you know, when we had that crash. My dad had developed a nice little nest egg to carry them through till the day that they departed from this earth. And in 2008, he lost 75% of that nest egg. I started sweating because I started thinking, how am I going to take care of them and provide for them? But that's one of the best places you can be, you know? Like Cheryl, you go through something like Cheryl has been where you don't know if you're going to live or die. And you know for certain, I mean, it's reality. Your next breath depends upon Him. How many of you took breathing for granted this morning? And your heartbeat for granted this morning? See, these times of lack and necessity are some of our best times. Our culture and the world teaches us pride and independence that we can provide for ourselves. And this is the real problem that happens. We become our own God. I can take care of myself. I can control my life. I'm in charge. If something happens, I have enough money to bail myself out. But daily bread teaches us of God's limitless love, His incomprehensible omniscience, the fact that He knows me, He knows what I need. How many of you have had a miracle or a provision or something come through and you were just amazed that God was so concerned with such a detail in your life? He knew every need. His unfailing faithfulness, God never fails us. And if the need isn't met and we go without, then His grace is always there sufficient to take us through the need. So He never fails us. his unfailing faithfulness, and his minute involvement. The fact that he's involved in every step. One of the most notable times in my life that I'll never forget is when I transitioned from full-time ministry, which I was in full-time ministry for 26 years, and then 10 years ago I had to make a move into secular employment. Now, what is a guy who's been a pastor all of his life, no college, no formal training, how is he going to go out and get a job in this secular world, right? Do you know that in the transition, I went from one job to a advertising agency and then into the job that I have now, I never missed one paycheck. And I was amazed. And it wasn't like I was out beating the street with resumes and interviews. And it was just like connecting the dots. And it was God who supernaturally opened up the way. When I interviewed for the job that I have now, it was originally for an AV manager. And there were only two guys that were going for the job, myself and this other guy. The other guy was he worked for Northrop Grumman, and he had been an AV manager for over 20 years. Now, if you were the hiring manager, who would you pick? Not me. My boss that hired me later on told me that after the interview process, for some reason, that other guy decided he didn't want the job after all. Wonder who made up his mind on that. God is just, I mean, when you think about his unfailing faithfulness, his minute involvement, that he's intimately involved in the details of your life, he knows every need. And we should never fear or be anxious. No need for any anxiousness or fear. This is what the daily bread is all about. Blessed be the Lord who daily loadeth us with benefits. Just think about that for a moment. We love each other, we care for each other, we try to stay involved in each other's lives, and yet even at best, we might stay involved in each other's life on a weekly basis. You know, once a week, twice a week, we see each other and get to connect and catch up. But God is with us how often? On a daily basis. That's what the ministry of the Holy Spirit was all about, you know. Jesus was telling his disciples, who were freaking out a little bit because he was about to leave, he said, look, you don't understand, it's good for you that I leave. Why? Can you imagine what it was like being a disciple around Jesus in those days? Having Jesus as a resource, you were always with him. You could go up to him at any time and ask him a question, or ask him for prayer, or ask him about a need in your life, or ask him for understanding and wisdom. And can you imagine having Jesus in your life the way the 12 disciples did, and having him there always to turn to, and yet he says, when I go, I'm going to send you another comforter. And the Holy Spirit is going to be to you what I have been in my earthly ministry. And so now Jesus is not just ministering to 12 disciples. He's ministering to millions of Christians on that personal, intimate, detail-by-detail, moment-by-moment basis. And you don't have to, you know, like the disciples of old, you don't have to wait for Peter to stop talking and for James to get finished with his question. And you have immediate access to the throne of God by the Holy Spirit. He's another comforter who does in your life exactly what Jesus did in the disciples' life. And he's always there for you. And every day he's involved in your life. And every day you have full access to him. And I have full access to him. And if you start to pray first, it's no big deal. I can pray at the same time. And the Holy Spirit distinguishes between the two. The care, the daily loading us with benefits where God is with us every step of the way, you are never alone. But learning how to trust in that, all of the securities, all of the options we have in the natural world really rob us of that awareness and faith of daily bread. Today, God is with me. This very hour, this very moment, God is providing what I need. And unfortunately, we have to go through times of lack and times of trial and despair for that faith in the daily bread to really be sharpened and exercised. Look here at Exodus chapter 16, verse 14. When the dew had gone up, there was on the face of the wilderness a fine flake-like thing, fine as frost on the ground. And when the people of Israel saw it, they said to one another, "What is it?" This is it's either the New American Standard or the ESV version. I forget which version it is. Remember in the King James, verse 15 says that the people call it manna. And manna means, what is this? Right? They pick up this thing off the ground. What are we supposed to do with this? Well, you're supposed to eat it. That was bread. That was manna from heaven. For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, "It is the bread that the Lord hath given you to eat. This is what the Lord hath commanded. Gather of it, each of you, as much as he can eat. You shall take an omer according to the number of the persons that each of you has in his tent." And the people of Israel did so. They gathered, some gathered more, some gathered less. And when they measured it with an omer, whoever gathered much, and this is important, whoever gathered a lot of manna had what? Nothing left over. And whoever gathered little had no lack. Just demonstrating the point, God knows exactly what you need, and his provision is perfect. And sometimes if we think, well, his provision is not enough for me, that's God's way of letting you know you need to cut back because God has allotted for you a certain amount. Some may get more, some may get less, but whatever he amounts for me and for you is perfect. It may be different. I may wish I had as much as you have, or vice versa, but we all learn to be content. This is God's lot for me in my life, God's provision for me, and so this is what I live by, and this is a miracle because this is God caring for me on a daily basis. But they did not listen to Moses. Some left part of it till the... Isn't that the flesh? Isn't that human fear? Well, I better store some away tonight because I don't know, you know, what if God sleeps in late tomorrow morning and I don't get my share? And see, that's the thing that God was really working towards. He wanted them to have faith in daily prayer. He wanted that faith to be exercised on a daily basis, every day. And he didn't want them to start to be secure in their abundance or secure in their supply. He wanted their hearts always looking to him. It bred worms, it stank. Moses was angry with them. God was teaching them, we live day by day. We live with faith and strength for today. I just got to make it through today. And it's our society that trains us to think about tomorrow or retirement. Or what happens when I get sick? Or the whole thrust, the whole message of our culture is Antichrist. The whole thrust of our culture is teaching us to rely on ourselves and not trust God. You've got to see it for what it is. You can call it wisdom, and there is wisdom in saving up. I don't want to leave that out. That is part of the scriptures. But this trust in daily bread has got to override anything we save up or store or any plans we have with our 401ks and otherwise. This is where our life is. Morning by morning they gathered it, each as much as he could eat. But when the sun grew hot, it what? It melted. Why? Because God was teaching them. I want your faith to be exercised tomorrow morning just like it was this morning. You're going to have to draw nigh to God tomorrow. You're going to have to seek his face tomorrow. You're going to have to reach out to God in faith tomorrow just like you did this morning. And in that way, you'll never be able to relax in your faith and trust in what you've stored up. Deuteronomy chapter 8 describes the real problem that happens, verse 7. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land of brooks, of water, of fountains and springs flowing out in the valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley, of vines and fig trees and pomegranates and olive trees and honey, a land in which you will eat bread without scarcity, in which you will lack nothing, a land whose stones are iron and out of whose hills you can dig copper. And you shall eat and be full, and you shall bless the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. In America, this is where we're living. We have no concept of how the rest of the world lives. We have no concept of what it is to search through a dumpster for our next meal, to scratch for just a few crumbs to feed our families. And he says, when you've eaten and you are full, take care that you do what? Lest you forget the Lord your God. It's easy to forget, isn't it? When you have your fridge full and your cabinets full and money in the bank, it's really easy to forget how much you need God. And so that's why the principle of daily bread is so important. Take care lest you forget the Lord your God by not keeping his commandments and his rules and his statutes which I command you this day. Watch what happens in verse 13. When your hearts and flocks multiply and your silver and gold is multiplied and all that you have is multiplied, then your heart be lifted up, you forget the Lord your God because he's brought you to this place. This is not of your own. And in verse 17, beware lest you say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand has gotten me this wealth. If God had allowed that manna to remain until the following day, then the trust, the security would have been, well, you know, I was wise and I saved and I store it up and now we're eating because I thought ahead. And the trust would no longer be in God. I put there in your notes, prosperity breeds independence. Money is a powerful force. I want you to see money goes a lot deeper than just going to a store and buying what you need or want. Money is a powerful force. It breeds independence. I don't need God because I can go buy anything I need. And if something breaks, I can fix it. I have the resources, and it's become so perverted in our culture that now even when we don't have the money, we've got credit, right? That's one of the biggest problems in our nation. I can fix this. Amazing how the U.S. government thinks that they can fix it just by printing more meaningless, worthless money. But see, that prosperity, it breeds an insanity that says, I no longer need God. I can take care of myself. It breeds a pride of being, I'm in control. With this money, with these resources, I can dictate the direction of my life. It's perversion, folks. It takes us away from that dependence and humility of relying upon God. And it results in rebellion because we begin to actually think, I'm the master of my life. Better for us to be in poverty and know how to depend upon God instead of rich and rebellious, pretending to be our own God. Prosperity is a dangerous, dangerous thing. Matthew chapter 6, verse 24, Jesus says it this way, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Impossible. Our heart, our affections cannot be divided in that way. And most of us live by the dollar. This whole society lives by the dollar. You get up and you go to work every day for the dollar. And I'm not saying sleep in the morning. You need to get up and go to work. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just trying to make the point. The dollar dictates our life. I've got to get up, I've got to be on this schedule, I've got to go to work at this time for the dollar. And though that's a necessity of being in this life, our heart cannot be there. We have to make sure our heart is trusting in God and not in the money and not in the system. In your notes, I put there, in the realm of sustenance and money, you live in one of two kingdoms. You have either one of two masters. Your heart is either dominated by the lordship of your heavenly provider or by the lordship of money. But you can't live in both. I have a list in here somewhere about how to know where you're living. He says in verse 25, therefore I tell you, do not be anxious about life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your money, what you will put on. Boy, that's hard to live there, isn't it? I mean, every now and then I've had a few fleeting moments in the reality of verse 25, but most of the time we are anxious and worried about this bill, or where am I going to get money to do that? And he says, is not life more than food? There's a whole lot more to life than just what you eat. Put it in perspective. Put it in proper priority. Is not the body more than clothing? The fact that you're still breathing air and pumping blood is a whole lot more important than the clothes you cover up with on the outside. That's what he's saying. So get your priorities right. Don't be anxious about your life. Don't be fearful. Anxiousness, worry, and fear are the first and foremost indicators that your heart is imprisoned by the lordship of money. Anxiousness, worry, fear about finances says one thing. My life depends upon money. And your heart should be, my life depends upon God. With or without money makes no difference. So that's where we really begin to tell where our heart is in this daily bread. He says, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more value than they? Again, look at the attention to detail. You would think that God is too important, too mighty, too busy to be worried about the sparrows or the birds. But yet he knows when each bird needs to be fed. Isn't that amazing? How much more does he know when you need to be fed? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? Verse 27, I meditate on that often. That is such a truth that I think could really set us free. You know, we get so worried about things. You can't add 1 hour. You can't even add 1 minute to your life. When God says it's your time, it's your time. You're out of here. You know, the King James, there's a little bit I don't want to say discrepancy, but there's a little bit of back and forth about how that should be interpreted. The King James interprets it, can you add 1 cubit to your height? And so it's kind of the same way. How many of you can grow another inch on will? I'm going to be an inch taller. Doesn't work, does it? It's futile. Why worry about that? It's you can't change it. And this is what he's saying in verse 27. If it doesn't do any good to worry and be fearful, then why be worried and fearful? Let's give our heart to God. Let's trust him for his provision. And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. I tell you, even Solomon in all of his glory was not arrayed like one of these. If God paints every flower in the field, how much more does he care for you every day? See, we forget, we don't operate, we don't live by the rules of this world system. We are children of the King. We live in a kingdom. We are seated with him in heavenly places. We live by a completely different set of rules. An opposite set of rules. And the power of our kingdom is infinitely greater than the power of this world. And so I don't live by the same rules of having to make my own way and provide for myself. I have a Father, a Shepherd, a King in heaven that takes care of my every need. Will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Interesting thing about Jesus and how he dealt with his disciples. Do you notice how many times He kind of scolds the disciples for their unbelief. And he scolds them for their unbelief a lot more than their sin. And it's just interesting to note that. And unbelief, I know, is sin. But he really gets after them for not having faith. Therefore, don't be anxious saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? The Gentiles seek after those things. It's pagan to worry about your sustenance. It's the pagans who don't have any hope in a God that's looking after them. Your heavenly Father knows what you need. But seek first the kingdom of God. And this is the, I just want to cover briefly this morning, two rules of finance. The first rule is this, verse 33, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be what? Added to you. You don't have to seek them. You don't have to strive for them. You don't have to make this the focus of all of your work and energy. You don't have to trust in yourself or in your job or in the government. You set your heart to seek God in his word and in prayer, and all of these things will be added to you. You will find, I don't know how this happened, just like me when I went from full-time ministry into the secular. I have no idea how it happened. I could not have put things together the way God did, but everything just kind of was added to me. It kind of fell in my lap, so to speak. It followed after me. I wasn't following after it. All these things will be added to you when you set your face to seek God in prayer, in his word, in ministry to others. Therefore, don't be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. These are the signs that I was talking about. Am I under the lordship of money? Or am I under the lordship of the provider? First is obvious, covetousness and greed. I mean, there are just some greedy people out there, and they will do anything to get more money. Well, I think that's pretty obvious. If that's in your heart, then you're under the lordship of this world system. Worry and fear, as Jesus just said, that's another sign that you're under the lordship of money. You're not free to be under the lordship of the great provider in heaven. Obsession, preoccupation, it's all you think about. Where am I going to get money for this? Or how can I make more money? You are what you think about. Where do you find your trust and security? You know, does that nervousness and fear comes because your savings account dipped under $100,000? What about plans and strategies? I didn't hear what you said, but I can just imagine what you said, Kevin. Plans and strategies. You know, this is what we're going to do, man. This, my 401k and my pension and everything is going to take care of me. Self-sufficiency and pride. I don't need God. Finance is a wonderful way that God has of directing our hearts back to him, along with a lot of other things. But when we find ourselves destitute, having nothing, boy, that really strikes home, doesn't it? Malachi chapter 3. This is the second way that we get involved in God's finance. Malachi chapter 3, verse 8. Will a man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you, God, in tithes and offerings? I think the tithe is one of the most genius inventions of God. And I say that for this reason. When you think of the tithe, we all know that a tithe means a tenth. And so God commanded his nation that out of all of their income and increase, they would give back 10%. So one out of every 10 sheep would be offered to God. You know, a tenth of all the grain would be offered back to God. If you make $100, $10 gets offered back to God. That's the tithe. And God here says, you're robbing me in that tithe because they were withholding it. I think the genius of the tithe is this. It shows you, number one, God's generosity, and that he lets you keep and use 90%. That's pretty generous. But I think there's also the genius in it. 10% is just enough of a bite, isn't it? I know when, and I know you have probably felt this because I feel it from time to time, when you're writing out your tithe check, doesn't that thought come across your mind sometimes? Man, I could really use that money. Susie needs a new pair of shoes, and Johnny needs that cavity filled, and the car needs new tires, and okay, God, I'll give you what's yours. We all go through that tension, that anxiety at times. And so God is incredibly generous to give us 90%, but yes, 10% has just enough bite to remind us, this is my faith statement that this came from God, and so this is being returned to God in thanksgiving. This belongs to Him. He says, you've robbed me in tithes and offerings. You are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. And look at verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, so that there may be food in my house, and test me in this. Test Him. God is calling you to test Him. Put me to the test. Bring the tithe into the storehouse and see if I don't open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings until it overflows. How much of a giver are you? How generous are you? One thing is for sure, none of us will ever be as generous as God has been with us. We can't even get close, right? But His generosity should inspire us to be generous. And if we cling and hold tight to our possessions and our time and our energy and our money, and we are very stingy with what we give, then we've got a problem. I think it just shows we don't really know and appreciate how much God has given to us. He says, but test me and bring that tithe in, and you'll see a supernatural supply start to happen in your life. How many of you, I know several of you in this room have told me of days gone by, and maybe you're even there now, that when you figure it all out on paper, it doesn't add up, but somehow at the end of every month, the bills are paid and God has come through and you don't know how it works, but it just keeps working. That's called supernatural supply. And it means that you have left the world system and you're now operating by the heavenly system of finance. It's real, and it works. Then I will rebuke the devourer for you. Things don't break down as much as they used to. Shoes don't wear out. Clothing doesn't wear out. It's real. It works. Try it. Put God to the test, he says. Then I put these notes about tithing in the New Testament. Nowhere, number one, nowhere in the New Testament is the Christian commanded or instructed to tithe. And we all go, yay! Right? Not so fast. Number two, nowhere in the New Testament is the commandment to tithe rescinded either. I mean, if you're going to state number one, you have to at least be honest enough to bring the balance and say, it's never been rescinded either. Okay? Number three, Jesus clearly states that as New Testament believers, our obedience is to far surpass the obedience of the New Testament, of the Old Testament believers, And so, you're probably sweating right now. Oh no, are we talking about 20%, 30%? That's not what we're talking about, okay? We're talking about here the condition of the heart. Are you a cheerful giver, or do you give grudgingly? And then number four, as new creations possessing the heart transformation of regeneration, should we give by the compulsion of a rule and a formula? You know, I think this is really why God doesn't specifically deal with tithing in the New Testament. I think it's because we are supposed to have grown past this point where it's by compulsion. Well, this is the formula, so whatever I make times 0.1, I'll figure out what I've got to give. We're supposed to be far beyond that, folks. We're supposed to be giving of a cheerful and willing heart. Our obedience to be generous and to give is to go far beyond the heart attitude of the Old Testament believer. Should we live by a rule and a formula, or should we give with glad hearts, rejoicing in the generosity of our Lord's salvation, knowing whatever we give, even if we gave it all, couldn't even begin to compare to how generous He's been with us? And so, you know, I mean, it's a big debate in the church. Tithe, don't tithe, 10%, no formula. You know, personally, that's up to you. That's between you and God. You're going to have to answer to God for that. You're not going to have to answer to me for that. So you're going to have to move by your own personal conviction and conscience and what you believe to be right before the Lord. I think there's nothing, I personally use the 10% rule as a baseline. And I think there's nothing wrong with that. I think that's probably a good idea. I think the Lord instituting the tenth, the tithe, was brilliant, like I said. But I think it's something that you really need to work out between you and the Lord and not do something just because the rule says so. How can I give and be generous and honor God in my giving because of all that He's given to me? And I'm not just talking about giving to the church. You know, when there's a need in the body, or a brother or sister or family member comes into a tragedy or a certain crisis, the scriptures make it clear we are to be ready to give. So I'm talking about giving on all levels. I'm not just talking about Westgate Chapel. Here in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6, and I'm winding this down. Now this I say, he who sows sparingly will also what? Reap sparingly. And he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. And so we see the law of sowing and reaping, and we begin to understand here, this is the test that he's talking about in Malachi when he says, bring into the house of God the tithes and the offerings, and test me, see if I don't prosper you. And one of the greatest exercises of faith is giving beyond yourselves, giving until it hurts, giving bountifully, and seeing how God will reward you. Each one must do it as he has purposed in his heart. This is what I was just saying. You don't give according to what I've purposed in my heart for you to give. You give according to what you have purposed in your heart before God to give. In other words, nobody else sets the standard. You've got to go to God and let God set your own personal standard for you and your family. And when you do give, it's not to be grudgingly. I don't know if I should say this or not. Terry and I got laughing the other day because we got a check, and the check was kind of all crinkled up and kind of in rough shape. And Terry just jokingly made the comment, yeah, I wonder if they had trouble giving that one up. You know, it was like pulling it. It was just a joke. We don't think that way. But it just, and the reason why it's kind of humorous is because we all go through it. So sometimes that check is hard to get out of our hands, right? Well, it's not supposed to be grudgingly, and it's not supposed to be under what? It's not supposed to be under compulsion. It's not supposed, I'm not supposed to compel you. And you're not supposed to be under the compulsion of any legalistic rule of, oh no, I'm not giving enough. You've got to figure out between you and God what's right. For God loves a cheerful giver. And I'm going to say something here, and don't use this as a loophole, but let me just go ahead and say it because it's true anyway. God's far more concerned with you giving cheerfully than the amount. That's the important thing. And so you've got to work that out between you and Father under the New Testament. We are supposed to be children of the King. We are supposed to be more mature, having grown past the rules and the formulas of the Old Testament. We're supposed to be giving because God lives in our heart and we want to give now. We're not being made to give. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that you always have all sufficiency in everything. You may have an abundance for every good deed. If you prove yourself to be a giver, God will make sure that you always have something to give, is what he's saying here. And so, what is your giving record? What is your track record? Are you a generous person, or are you a stingy person? And I'm going too long, so I'm going to cut it off here. We may have to finish this up next week, because in the few places that the New Testament talks about money, here in 2 Corinthians, then Philippians, we'll pick that up next week. It's important to understand what he's saying in each instance. But let's pull the plug on it here. We'll pick it up again. Father, thank you for your word. And Lord, we know and understand money is one of the most sensitive subjects we can talk about. And money has a way at tugging at our heartstrings. But Father, one thing is for sure. If we can't give you our money, then we sure can't give you our heart. And so, Father, we ask that even in this area, we would learn dependence upon you. We would learn the principle of daily bread, that we are never to trust in our storehouse. We're never to trust in our provision. We're never to trust in what we've laid aside for the future. Our trust has got to be every day in you and in you alone. There's nothing wrong with saving for the future, but somehow, Father, keep that daily bread faith sharp and active in our heart so that we don't fall into the carnality of thinking, I can be my own master and I don't depend upon anybody. Teach us the foolishness and the vanity of that. And Father, we give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.